Mumu, I can say absolutely anything. And
like
I have
an alter ego?
Literally, I have no problem
That's
saying...
That's wicked.
Yeah.
Sometimes I wish that I was in character in order to sort out my everyday problems.
That's so interesting.
Mm. Can I just say at this point, we actually have started recording. I hope you don't mind.
Oh, no.
So we would normally start with our theme, which we'll punch it in somewhere along the line. But I just thought that would be really nice. We're getting a real natural thing there. So feel free to continue.
One thing that made me think is I spoke to my old PE teacher not long ago, and he was listening to a podcast, or I think he was reading a book, which was basically saying that to develop an alter ego is a natural part of human nature, which is why kids do it. Like, kids will feel like they've got superpowers when they put on certain costumes, the same reason why a man might feel slightly different when he's wearing a suit.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think in, like, as you know, as someone who makes hats, as a designer, as well as a drag artist, when I design a hat, I'm making it for a character.
So cool.
And then when I'm a character, it's almost like I'm pulling from a part of me that exists, but I don't portray it to the real world, if that makes...
It's a hidden element of you.
Oh, big time, yeah. Big time. And it's also, like, back with the suit situation, when you wear a suit, you carry yourself differently. And it's the same with everyday clothing. When we wear everyday clothing, we carry ourselves differently, and it's the same with drag.
So how did you find your Madam Mumu then, your alter ego?
How did I become Madam Mumu, or how did I just find it? Because I think it's very natural in terms of finding the, you know, you just, when the moment you put on a sense of armor or a sense of your battle clothes, so to speak, or leave your front door, you're putting on a sense of uniform.
It switches, doesn't it?
A big time. It just, it's almost automatic in terms of developing the character and material. That just comes as you grow in confidence.
Okay, so you practice.
A big time.
But it's the task of doing it is your practice. So the performance almost becomes a practice, and that's the point where you very organically grow, the character grows within what you're doing.
Yeah.
I should say at this moment in time, we've started our podcast, but we've not said who's here. So let's just start real quickly, and then we can continue this. I'm sorry to interrupt, Elliot, but we've got Chris Garner. Say hi, Chris.
Hello.
He's there, so we can hear your voice. Charlie Barnes.
Hello.
The lovely Charlie. Elliot Reid is joining us again. Thank you, Elliot.
Hello.
And Danusia Francis as well.
Hello.
Joining. So let's go. I love this, that we're just starting. We're just starting fresh. Go on. Let's go. We were talking about modes, weren't we? I call it modes. So I have modes, podcast mode. Tom Knight has podcast, you know, whatever he is doing that. Teacher mode. I've got my onstage mode. And I don't ever sort of go, right, now I'm walking into Beach Sound Studios, I now must be in podcast mode. It just kind of just clicks.
Just clicks, yeah.
And I think there'll be a bit of a blur for me between onstage mode and in this room doing this mode. So... yeah, it's something that grows, isn't it?
Big time. I mean, I've always, as a gymnast, when you're competing, I've always found it fascinating. I will go on my run, for example, and I'll be like, oh my God, why do we do this to ourselves? Why do we put ourselves through this training? But for you as a competitor, you must just know that mode when it comes on and it clicks, surely.
Do you have to think about it, Danish?
Like you said, you don't have to think about it, but once you've got that leotard on, you've got your makeup on.
It's the same for me with my leotard on, yeah. I mean, it takes me ages, but yeah. Shouldn't joke, really, should I? But yeah, it's the process, isn't it, you go through to get to that stage.
Yeah, and I wonder if it's similar for you. Like, the bigger the crowd for me, the more I'm, like, in that mode and I'm, like, ready for it. And I love a big audience and just taking the energy from them.
I think it's funny enough, when you're in a theatre production or any form of show, or if people's energy is not, like, if it's like a negative energy, you really feel that and it really affects your performance. And if it's not an old worksman blaming his own tools, it's really hard to make
anything from nothing, isn't it?
Exactly. It's if you're getting a reaction from people and you're reading the room and you're able to be like, oh my God, they're really rowdy, it's a big crowd, it's going to be fun. Usually you can tell the moment you step out, like your drag friend. You know, if someone in a sense says something and you can respond really quickly, that's a really good judgment of how the crowd's going to be,
how receptive they'll be to it.
Yeah
Charlie, how much is that, because Charlie's joining us today as our musician in the studio, and you have your band Follow the Hawk, and I know that you perform in functions bands as well. I mean, how does that work for you? Is it a similar sort of thing that you sort of switch it on, or
Yeah, kind of. Like when you go out on stage, it doesn't matter how many people you're performing to, or personally, it doesn't matter how many people you're performing to, and you should make it like every single gig is the biggest gig you've ever played. Mm. Obviously, anyone that's been in local bands or smaller acts will know we're all very, very used to playing to three people in a venue. It happens all the time.
It does.
Best foot forward.
Yeah, exactly. But you've just got to go and put the best show on that you can at that moment. And obviously, it's not the same every single time. You take into account that someone might be having a bad day or something like that. But when you go on stage, it's just, switch, as you say, changes. And I've also got a little bit of experience in theatre land as well. And it's the same thing. You go out on stage and you become a character. And that's almost, the same on stage as a musician. I'm Charlie in my everyday life, wearing dungarees like it's normal. And then I go out on stage and I'm Charlie from Follow the Hawk. I'm loud, I'm boisterous, I'm very sweary.
Different beast.
Yeah, kind of, yeah. Very.
It's your escape, perhaps, isn't it?
Very drunk. Yeah. It is an escape, it is an escape. And you can hear that in the music as well, which is cool.
I think it wasn't something I was ever particularly aware of. Only within the last 5 or 6 years was I aware that I even did it. And it was listening to an interview with Paul Weller, which I think I've referred to in a previous podcast, and he was saying how he gets really nervous still before he performs, and how he said, and he was saying that he has to see the venue. I don't know if it's the same for you or for anyone that's performing. Like, I have to see the room I'm going to do it in, so I can get a feel for it. Even empty. So if it's a completely new venue, I have to go and look at it. That's my recce. You know, is obviously to make sure it's okay to play in, but also, all right, what's the potential here? And then, as soon as I step out onto that stage, it just clicks. And he said exactly the same. He said as soon as his foot hits that stage, all those nerves have gone. Mm. It's just fascinating.
I think, pardon me, when you have, say, for example, if you get booked for a gig and you don't know the venue, kind of anxiety builds because you think, okay, this is an unknown space. Mm. So by just going there, I mean, it has so many pros to it. It makes you look really professional because people are like, wow, they want to check the venue out beforehand. But it's getting rid of that bit of unknown, which is...
Removing that barrier.
It's really powerful. And it's I live by the saying, it's called prepare, prepare, prepare to avoid a piss poor performance. And it's
that's my dad's 6 P's. Yeah. Perfect planning prevents piss poor performance.
There you go.
There you go. Thank you, Bob Knight. There you go. It's first reference to the episode number 11? No, 12. Shit, we just did 11. Should have known as well. This is our second session for the day. And I think it would be really cool at this point just to sort of go around to see who we've got. I know we've got names, but just to hear a little bit about what each of you do. And obviously, Elliot, you're rejoining us. What's been happening since we last spoke to you? Episode 2 was really successful. We had a lot of real positive stuff come back and a lot of people were saying, you know, how amazingly motivational it was to hear your voice. So what's been happening for you since I last saw you?
So as a clinic, with the lockdowns, we've kind of just been rolling with the punches. So personal training for the majority of the time was online, mm-hmm. but we've still been able to treat people for injuries. And I think that one thing that we've definitely noticed is, I suppose, the waves in how the community is feeling. I think there's a lot more people with acute mental downturns or mental illness surrounding the current lockdown, far more in comparison to before.
Yeah.
So we're seeing a lot of patients now come to the clinic and a lot of clients as well for personal training. Who are presenting with pain or weight gain, which is the tip of the iceberg for what's going on underneath, which might be financial insecurity. It could be the fact that they feel like they've turned into hermits and they haven't been able to leave their living room. So it's interesting for us, but we're doing as best as we can to fulfill the needs of the community as well.
That's good. I think you guys have done amazingly well to keep going through it. And kudos to you, because there's a lot of people that need it. So. Mm.
Are you getting any like funding from the government to
a touch? Yeah, so we're getting a touch of funding to help with the overheads, but we're still about we've lost about 100 grand overall. Yeah, it's a bit, but we're rolling with the punches.
Yeah, yeah. I love the fact you're saying that with a smile on your face.
But you've got to, man.
You have got to. Yeah, and I'm sure knowing how proactive you are, mate. You you know,
it'll be fine.
Yeah, you will be absolutely fine. It's really tough for a lot of people out there, isn't it? I've seen it, you know, with a lot of my students in my school, the sort of mental health things, and in particular the beginning of lockdown two, you know, the amount of people who, oh no, we're going again, and it's almost like they had a time off from it, and then to go back has really like hit those anxieties even harder, I think, for a lot of people. But yeah, we've got a roll on it. We're in tier three now, so can't do anything. Can't even have a substantial meal and a beer, can we? But hopefully soon we will be able to. But is it okay for Christmas? We can meet two other households? Is that
three,
right?
I think.
I don't really understand it. But
three in total, yeah.
Three in total. So. Okay, cool.
And I think the United Kingdom is going to think, oh, okay, well, that's three in total on five separate days.
Yeah.
Well, rather than three in total.
That's what
the
I thought.
Day.
I thought, this is great. Yeah. It's okay. I can get all the family in. Yeah. Go three every day, different. But then...
I think in terms of the way they branded this, I mean, it kind of, you know, it doesn't make sense how if we're in tier three, we can still go to London, which is in tier two. It's almost like if you're in tier three, you shouldn't be going anywhere.
Stay in tier three.
Yeah. And it's a, you know, a catch 22 because you've got to, you know, we need to survive. We need to be human and live.
For some reason, this is the most optimistic I've seen. British people, I think, are traditionally quite pessimistic. But when it comes to lockdown, they always look on the bright side. So, like,
you can meet, that's all they've got.
Yeah, you can meet three people. That means once every day. That's like 15 households overall. Yeah. We're in tier three, but we must still be able to grab a pint. We must be able to still go around to other people's houses.
Yeah. Is the answer to that. Yeah. No, you cannot. Moments of sadness. Okay, so let's, Chris, just tell us a little bit about. I know we've said who you are, but what do you do?
So I work as a milliner during the week, so Monday to Friday. Well, at the moment, full time, because I've got no drag work. So I work as a milliner. A milliner is someone who makes hats. So my label is Julian Garner Headwear. It was a label that I've dreamt of since I was 11, when I lived in Zimbabwe. And then an opportunity presented itself where I could support my label by working 8 days a month, earning the same amount of money I was earning when I was working in London in buying and product development, working as a drag artist, and hence how Madame Moo Moo came about. So yeah, that's what I do.
And Madame Moo Moo, is she solely based in Maidstone at Moo Moo?
Yeah, it's kind of a tough one because... the owner obviously, you know, offered me the position, and how it came about full time is I an act didn't turn up, and I was like, okay, well, we got to put something on, so we kind of put on this last minute emergency burlesque show, and from that he was like, oh, we don't have a compare, who's going to compare? And I said, oh, I will. And I didn't have an answer material, I just thought I would go out there and do it. And this comes back to the armor of once you've got your drag on, your makeup, your costume, your leotard, your uniform, you're going to just, your guitar, I don't want to leave you out.
My dungarees.
Yeah, your dungarees. Yeah. You just have all the power in the world. And I kind of went out there and I did what I did and I introduced the next act and I came back to have a costume change, which I never did before. I was kind of just like a host and I would sit people at the table and then sit on a window ledge and watch the show. And my boss was laughing and said, you know, you can earn XYZ doing this every weekend, and a penny dropped, and I was like, fuck,
yeah,
wow,
okay, I'll have some of that.
So I kind of mulled over it for a while, and about a week later I had my 3 month notice into Harrods, where I was working at the time, and they're all like, oh, you know, what are you going to do? And I was like, I'm going to run my label. And they're like, how are you going to support it? And it was such a corporate world. And I was like, well, for the last 2 years, I've been working part time as a drag artist. And they were like, what? And I was, yeah. And it was funny because my the guy that worked on the desk opposite me, he would often say, you know, well, your eyes look really pretty, like, what's going on? And I'll be like, oh, I just had my eyelashes tinted. But in actual fact, I had like leftover mascara on my eyes, and then I'll come in some weeks and I'll be covered in glitter, and he'll be like, have you been crafting again? And I'll be like, yeah,
house full of glitter.
And I remember stood at a printer on my first night as Madame Moo Moo in the opening, and I had kind of to get back from London to Maidstone, get off the train, get to Moo Moo and do my makeup. So I was like, I'll get tucked and ready in London. So at literally 5:15, I got my tights on and my control pants, and you know, tucked and put my suit back on, and I was stood at the printer printing out reports going, I'm in stockings and no one knows I'm in stockings.
That was a real blur of your modes.
Yeah, really. It was really confusing. I was like, I wonder how many other, like, you know, heads of departments are wearing sexy lingerie under their suit. It was really interesting.
I would like to believe more than we probably imagined.
Yeah, yeah, well, I hope there are more.
That's great. All right. Well, thank you for that. And we'll come back a little bit to how the creation of Madame Moo Moo and how that's built and your label as well. And so, Charlie, just tell us a bit about you. I know you're a musician.
I don't think I can follow that.
Well, no, you can give it a go. I want to know what's under the dungarees.
Yeah, I'm wearing stockings right now. I play music, as you just said. Yeah. And I've played since I was a teenager. I started learning guitar myself, taught myself. My dad is a guitarist, my mum is a singer, so it was kind of built into me
on the cards, wasn't it?
Yeah, I learned piano when I was really young, and then obviously as I went into secondary school, I was like, oh, I'm too cool for piano. Little did I know I was not too cool for anything. So when I got to about 13, 14 years old, me and my friend Robbie at school, we decided to start taking guitar lessons, which turned into a bit of a DOS, really, a way of getting out of class. Mm. And for the first little while, we didn't really learn anything because we were just mucking around. And then we started to teach ourselves. And I've been with him now as a musical partner for years. And he's been in nearly every single band that I've ever been in. He's my lead guitarist in Follow the Hawk.
That's cool.
I don't really know if there's much more to the story than
that. Well, what sort of stuff does Follow the Hawk do? I mean, you're a rock band?
Yeah, like hard rock, a mix of like kind of grunge and punk, and there's some more poppy, catchy elements in there.
It's really feisty stuff, isn't it?
It is very feisty. We've got a new EP coming out in 2021, which is a little bit softer, more commercial than the first EP that we released in 2018, called Keeping Up Appearances, that you can listen to on Spotify.
Nice. You'll get your chance to plug, don't worry about that. It's coming. It's coming.
Making sure I get in now.
As many times as you can. Yeah. Just get that phrase in. Yeah, so I try and keep on keeping up appearances.
Yeah. So hopefully this EP will come out, and we've been recording it with Ben Waters of Forgotten Media Group, who's amazing. He recorded our first one as well. And we're just going to, as soon as lockdown finishes, I just want to play shows again. You know what it's like.
Yeah.
You know what it's like. Before, actually, we all know what
we
it's
all
like
know, yeah.
in all of our businesses. Getting out there and doing that thing that we love so much. And it's really weird. What Elliot was saying before about the first lockdown, how everyone was as optimistic as possible. And even myself, I remember being like, oh, well, you know, we'll just get through this and then it will be all right.
Yeah,
it
was the same. Back in September, I was saying.
Yeah,
to
exactly.
We'll have gigs in September.
Yeah, and I'll be able to do the Christmas shows and stuff like that, and it'll be fine. And then second lockdown hit, and I was like, oh god. it was like the breakdown that had been waiting to happen.
Oh mate.
I just wanted. There's no end in sight. I just need to get out and play. Which is a very selfish thing to think of, really.
It's not. It's our therapy, I think. And then again, that's not something I ever really realised until... I mean, I've been fortunate to have one or two gigs that's socially distanced and sort of during the period where we weren't in another lockdown. And I didn't... When I did that first one, it was emotional. Like, standing up there thinking, wow, I really miss playing Mr. Brightside.
Oh, yeah.
Did I ever think I would say that, you know, and I was sitting there thinking, like, just the interaction with the crowd and all of those things, you know, suddenly it really hit me that, oh man, this is, you know, I need this. This is obviously part of who I am. And I think when you do something so much, it just to not do it.
Yeah.
It's like removing a limb, isn't it? You know, it's constantly, it's tough to deal with, I suppose. But.
We had a gig booked for the 12th of December and then lockdown happened, and then it was like, okay, lockdown's gonna finish, we'll go into tier two, like, and we'll all be fine and we'll still be able to play the show. And Kent's in tier three.
Yeah,
oh, bloody great. And that was really disheartening. I think we got ourselves so geared up for it and ready.
You were ready to go,
and we had some ideas, like we were going to do a mini acoustic set beforehand, which is something we'd never done before, and we were all really excited. And now we're just waiting again.
But you're still busy, like in the studio and stuff. Like you,
yeah.
What we should say at this point, we are recording this in December, but this podcast is going to be released in January.
Yes.
And thank you very much for coming to see me in December. But you've actually got a Christmas song coming, and I listened to it last night, and I listened to it after listening to your other tracks, and I actually thought that I'd got the wrong
track.
Band. I thought this is not them, surely. And it's a complete and utter change.
So
I love it, by the way. It's brilliant.
Thank you very much. So in 2015, we wrote and recorded a Christmas song, which was in part helped by... We wrote the music, and we just couldn't really get the lyrics right. And luckily enough, my uncle, who's a musician, sat down with us, and we kind of hashed out loads of ideas. And it ended up being a song about my granddad, my uncle's father. And it was very poignant in the lyrics, but then obviously it was a hard rock track as well. Mm. So we released that in 2015, and we dedicated that to a charity called Community Christmas, in which people could download the track and pay money for it, and then all that money would go to the charity who help elderly, lonely, vulnerable people over the festive period, people that don't usually have a place to go or people to see
contact
at Christmas. And then 2020 happened 5 years later, and me and Martin our bassist sat down and we were like, wouldn't it be good just to kind of re-release the Christmas song with a new fresh edge? And he was like, yeah. And he plays piano as well, so he started sitting down and he was playing the piano. And he's like, what about something like this? And he played a nice little piano bit. And I was like, wow, that really, like, resonates with what's going on at the moment. And, like, I sang the vocal over the top of it in a lower register, a more solemn style. Mm. We just went from there. And it became almost like a Coldplay-esque anthem
it, it
sort
is just
of
totally different
song. Yeah,
so
it's really
but
different.
But it is very... does tie in very nicely with what's happening at the moment.
I thought that was a
really good trick. I do think it will hit a lot of the feels for a lot of people.
Hopefully,
as well.
Yeah. And we're dedicating that to Re-Engage, who are a charity who look after, once again, elderly, vulnerable, and lonely people all year round. Mm. So they have taken on Community Christmas have joined forces with them. And instead of paying for the download, you can download the track for free, and there's a link to go straight to the website. Cool. and donate there, because we thought people are low on cash at the moment.
Yeah,
you can't really...
Well, despite this podcast coming out in January, do make sure you put up on our socials now.
Yeah.
Anything like that, and it's a little way of helping and putting something out there to support it as well. So yeah, it sounds great, and I'll encourage all of you in here to have a listen to it, and
get it to number one.
Yeah, let's get it. Yeah. Let's do it. I wonder what will be number one. That will be number one.
Not another song about sausage rolls, hopefully.
No.
This year.
No.
Although that's good as well. That was for charity.
Of course, well, sausage rolls are just in general, right?
Yeah, exactly. Mm.
You heard it here first. Follow the Hawks, Christmas number one. imminent. we're going to skip over you, Elliot. I'm sorry, mate, but we're going to talk to Danusia very quickly. Danusia, tell us a little bit about you. Who are you? What do you do? Why are you here?
So I'm a gymnast. I've been doing gymnastics almost all my life since I was 5. I used to compete for Great Britain, and now I compete for Jamaica, and I've qualified for the Tokyo Olympics. So definitely relate to you all with the waiting game. It's obviously been delayed a year with coronavirus, but I also do coaching and I do a bit of stunt work as well. So yeah,
nice
busy.
Stunt work.
Yeah.
Anything notable that we would know that you've been in?
So there's a movie coming to Netflix called The Midnight Sky with George Clooney. It's out on December 23rd. And then Wonder Woman.
Wait, you weren't stunt woman for George Clooney, right?
No. No, I don't look enough like him, apparently. But I was doubling another actress, okay. Tiffany. And then Wonder Woman 1984 comes out, I believe, December 25th.
Oh,
but
cool.
So nothing I've been in's come out yet, but those two are coming
but
soon.
But it's on its way. Everything is on hold for you, really.
Yeah, literally.
Oh, so frustrating. Okay, yeah. So tell us a little bit about Tokyo. That's next year now.
Yeah, so they delayed it pretty much a whole year.
Right, okay. And you're still having to keep that level of prep. I mean, I couldn't even begin to imagine the level of preparation and training you need to go to be Olympian.
It's a lot.
Because I complain about the 45-minute sessions that we boxed together, Elliot, let's face it. But, I mean, how are you sort of, because there must be a mental sharpness you've got to maintain for an extra year. How on earth are you doing that? What's your Wow.
Yeah.
Tell me the secrets.
Well, and also at the age of 26, I'm quite old in the gymnastics world.
Right.
So I retired once before for a year and a half. So it's just definitely been like a dragged out process. In 2012, I was reserved for the Great Britain team. And then in 2016, I qualified to the Olympic test event, but Jamaica chose to use another athlete. So this is like my third shot of getting to the Olympics. And then now it's been delayed another year. But I'm so proud of myself to have qualified. So that's kind of a peace of mind that I'm definitely going, even though it's delayed. And yeah, luckily I've got great coaches and great atmosphere in training. So training's not something I dread or anything like that, but it's definitely tough. And this body definitely feels older than 26 each day. Like my back hurts and just joints. And Elliot gives me massages. Luckily, he's a good one to have around.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. We should point it out at this moment that you are to be wed. It isn't just a really weird relationship. No, we've just highlighted.
I am an osteopath as well.
Yeah. Because I mean, we came in, he's offered us all massages as we came in, just with two broomsticks from a distance. It's very therapeutic. It's good. That's great. I genuinely cannot even begin to like imagine that mental preparation. And, you know, I know that for you, much like we've been discussing, that switching on of the mode probably comes quite naturally now. But we will be following and keeping a close eye on your progress and
thank you
in Tokyo. Gosh, and it's with your gym stuff. What is it specifically? Do you do the floor? Is it the floor? I mean, yeah. I'm so ignorant with it all.
So
I don't
do
know their names. I know what they look like.
Yeah, so I do artistic gymnastics. So for women, that's four events: floor, vault, bars, and beam.
Wow.
So you got one out of four. Good work.
Thank you very much. Charlie, have you ever done any gym stuff?
Gym stuff or gymnastics?
Gymnastic stuff. Ever been on the floor? Is this with the tape? Do you do the one with the tape?
No, that's a different one.
Is that completely different?
I lay down a lot on the floor, if that makes it's comfy.
Yeah.
A padded floor is probably even better.
Sprung floor. Yeah, nice. I think we should do some sort of Charlie Barnes, Tom Knight gym routine, floor routine.
Floor routine. It's literally just laying down. Yeah.
Rolling. Trying
I'm
to
sure
get up.
I can get you doing cartwheels.
Okay.
I'm not sure about that.
Let's
not,
do it.
My centre of gravity is not good enough. I actually, I love gymnastics. Like, when the Olympics comes around, it's probably my favourite part of the Olympics. It's just so artistic and great.
I think gymnastics is one of those sports which is obviously impressive. Mm. I think when people watch, for example, boxing, they see two men throwing fists, but they don't really know how hard it is. Same with 100 meter sprint, you just see someone running fast. Gymnastics is obviously impressive.
Yeah, you see someone with real superpowers. I think this is the way I see it. Like, to get from that corner to that corner, and in between, you've done about 1,000 flips and spins and twists. Yeah. You know, whereas you know, for me, a trip over and a little forward roll, maybe. You know,
as long as you stick that land in, though, and you're all right.
Landing and jazz hands at the end, is that?
Yeah,
that's
always,
how they teach
always
it, right?
The nice jazz hands.
Well, I've got that bit sorted.
Spirit fingers.
There you go. See? There.
Halfway there.
I think I'm way more, less than halfway. obviously, you know, the idea behind the podcast is that, you know, it originated with it being a bit of a weight thing for me, but it's kind of moved towards the sort of mental health aspects a lot more, because I think that the health and fitness things kind of fall within that anyway. We've spoken about lockdown. You know, I'd be curious to know how it sort of really... you know, the impact for you guys with regards to just stopping everything. You know, what was your initial thoughts when back in March we were like, nothing to do? Where did you go to, Chris? I mean, because...
Oh, jeez. I feel like it's opening a can of worms. So when I've got to kind of go back to kind of explain how I am, where I am. When I first moved to this country in 2004...
Just tell people where you...
I used to live in Zimbabwe in Africa, southern Africa. And when I moved to this country in 2004, I didn't stop. And what I mean by not stopping is in terms of being able to cope with what I experienced, I just worked. At one stage, I had three jobs and it was, you know, Monday to Sunday. And I kind of... That's how it's always been with me. And I've always known that there's been an underlying issue with what I went through, but kind of never really faced it. And when COVID hit, all of a sudden there was this downtime and you could think, and
those things bubble to the surface a little
correct
bit.
And
would you be happy to share a little bit about
I think it's a way of dealing with it. It's I've been diagnosed just recently. I mean, to be honest, to get to that diagnosis, I was kind of passed from post to post, but I suppose it's back to the funding of the government. The first therapist I dealt with, which was on IESO therapy, which is an online therapy, and he basically said that what I went through, I was showing symptoms of PTSD. And I was like, Jesus, that's quite like, you know, it seemed quite strong. And then basically I spoke to my doctor because I was waiting for paperwork to come through. And then they spoke to mental health, and, you know, they were like, oh, this person doesn't need to be seen, they're fine. To which my doctor was like, they do, thank God. And now I've obviously got a severe anxiety disorder. And it's obviously I'm taking medication for it, but I'm very anti taking drugs of any form, just because I think you've got to deal with the pain. So I've had like two therapy sessions at the moment with an amazing charity, which are called We Are With You, which have actually been set up because of COVID.
Right.
And it's frustrating because for me, my issues aren't coming necessarily from COVID. My anxiety has been heightened because of COVID, because it's that fear of losing everything again. But, you know, I'm grateful that I've been seen to by someone rather than, you know, not been seen by anyone at all.
Yeah.
Admittedly, if I could go private, I would, but the prices of private therapists are like crazy, but rightly so, because, you know,
it's such an amazing amazing job that they do.
Yeah,
it?
Big time.
And they can somehow kind of just, they look into your brain and just know you. And that's what I found with the therapist I had anyway, that over the telephone, this lady was within about 5 minutes able to just get everything about me just from the, you know, the answers that I'd maybe given to the questions she'd had.
Yeah, it's also the tools that my therapist is called Martina, and she's Irish. And I was really worried at first where I was like, oh, because you've got to gel with your therapist. You've got to kind of think to yourself, am I going to be okay with this person? And the moment she picked up the phone and introduced herself, I was like, I like the sound of you. Mm. You seem really kind of easy to talk to. And she has been. And the tools are really interesting, and kind of how that doubt monster, that imposter syndrome that we have that makes you feel the way you feel, how you can kind of, you know, get down to the bottom of it by doing, you know, certain exercises. And
it was Sam Supple, who appeared on a podcast with us a couple of episodes ago. He actually introduced us, didn't he? And in his podcast, he talked about, I can't remember exactly what he called it, but it was like the little mischievous voice in your head.
Oh,
and
big
it's
time.
Often that, you know, a tiny little, I suppose, like an id, you know, that sort of little character being a little demon and putting all those doubts into your mind. But yeah, and you're cracking on with your therapy. You're feeling.
Yeah,
there's still some way to go.
A lot.
Feeling better.
Yeah, I think there's I wouldn't say I'm feeling better. I think there's a lot of things that I need to address. But I am, like, I don't want to sound dramatic, but I think it's good to talk about it. I've got some work to do, definitely. But, you know, we'll get there. Nothing. Anyway. I've been through worse. Nothing I can't handle. So
yeah, sure.
We've got this.
And like you say, though, the physical act of just sharing it, I think is the starting point, isn't it?
I also think it's good for you know, in Zim, that whole kind of feeling of boys don't cry, it's everywhere, but I just felt like in South Africa, in that part of the world, it was such a macho environment. It was incredibly, you know, cis man, you know, I am a man and I must not cry and I must not show any form of emotion. When I moved to this country, I really liked how kind of emotional people were. And I once went to America and I was like, oh my God, they're so emotional. It's like, calm down. But it's actually so important. And, you know, I shouldn't really judge by people being, so it's taught me loads about, you know, myself and about how to treat others and being a bit more mindful.
Yeah.
Of other people's reactions. But yeah, I think it's good that men do talk about these situations and talk more about what
I don't
experience.
Think enough do.
No,
I do think,
at
you
all.
Know, and that's the whole idea behind the podcast is to sort of make it happen a little bit more. And just in general, not just men, I think in general, people, you know, are often worried about how their true thoughts and their true feelings might hurt somebody else. When actually, it's far, I see it, maybe I'm just too blasé. I think it's much better to say, you know, let's say, for example, Elliot's done something that's really annoyed me. rather than me just festering and having that annoyance there. I think it's better to say, Elliot, look, that's really bothered me, because, and then that helps to repair your relationship. I know that's just such a simple way of looking at it, but yeah, I think it's right to do that. And I think it's a sign of a good relationship when you can say, yeah, Elliot, look, this, I'm unhappy about this.
Yeah, and I think, interesting, you know, you
not that I am unhappy. No, I don't.
But Chris, you mentioned a couple of things. Obviously, when you're living as a minority in a country where for you to speak on behalf of yourself or your minority is stifled, you then once again can't express that. So I can imagine how that was kind of, you know, even in the context of what happened in Zimbabwe, I'm sure that must have presented some distress for you. But also, there was a quote from a psychologist who said that people present with mental illness when, he said the way to explain it is, imagine a balloon that is gradually being filled up with more and more water. Eventually it's going to burst at its weakest points, and that might present as PTSD, might present as anxiety or depression. But to take that mess that a lot of us accumulate under our own knowledge or without our knowledge, to then have to shift through that, through therapy, is extremely challenging, but at the same time extremely rewarding as well, because to be able to organise that chaos that we've created in our own minds.
And to have those tools to deal with it as well.
Priceless. I think, same as you, I spent a bit on therapy during the first lockdown. Best money I've spent in my life, without a doubt. I cannot think of anything I've spent money on better. Because I think I have a slightly different, I suppose, relationship with that voice in my head, because it was big. But my therapist taught me to understand that voice and realize that it was actually trying to help me in a roundabout way. And to be able to look into that voice or into that abyss of darkness and realize, oh, okay, you can actually organize this. There's actually a tool for all of these things. There's a tool for aggression. There's a tool for jealousy. There's a tool for shame. All these things can help you, but you have to order them and understand them first, and then you can use them.
Definitely the understanding part of it.
It's one of my lessons that, well, not like workshop things that I've been given, is it's called a hot thought. And you have these kind of hot thoughts that make your anxiety go through the roof, and you feel like, oh my God, like, why is this happening? And then next to your hot thought, which you would write out and describe, are two columns. And one is evidence for the hot thought, that what is making you have that, and then evidence against it. And when I first did it, I had this hot thought, and the column for evidence for it was just filled, but the column next to for the evidence, you know, against it was minimal, which really makes you go, wow, it is just the power of the mind, which is so incredibly strong and kind of imaginative in a sense. And I suppose that's, you know, I've always said that my imagination's my greatest asset. Is it? Because it's, you know, it can possibly...
It's running wild, isn't it?
Yeah,
and it's taming it.
Yeah.
Fundamentally, you've got to learn, well, the tools that you've been given, and I suppose the processes that I might have gone through, or that we've all gone through in different stages and different paths, have helped you to sort of tame it and sort of go, well, actually, you're in my mind. I own you. You know, I control you. So, but it's, that's the simple way to look at it. But it's far more complex than that, I think.
What we've seen with our clients is that image of that bursting water balloon, when it bursts, that's often a trigger for people to eat, or for people, just to bring it back to the weight loss theme. But once again, you know, people are very individualistic. Some people eat to comfort themselves, and other people might experience, for example, bulimia, where they'll throw up, and that will be their way of, I suppose, releasing the pressure.
Releasing some of the water from the balloon.
Yeah, because obviously, you know, everyone around here has different experiences of that, and we've got the eating side of things, but then obviously from your side of things, Danusia, people, when they reach that limit, when it comes to the pressure that they're under with gymnastics, they might also have very different defense mechanisms of dealing with that pressure as well.
Yeah, definitely. I've seen both sides in gymnastics, like friends with eating disorders, and then other times when they're eating too much to the detriment of their sport. Obviously, you have to be in great shape to do the things we do in gymnastics. So, yeah, and then getting that control at that level of pressure as well, because it's not just like for an everyday person to be in shape. It's to be in shape to do high-level gymnastics. So I think it's like even another level or another element when it comes to sports, or obviously I can only talk for gymnastics, but yeah, and then being in a leotard
as well.
How do you handle
that pressure? Are there any tools that you know, any tools that you have at your disposal? What do you do?
Because
I feel that there's some people that can handle different elements of pressure and just don't think about it. Because with certain aspects of my life, there are certain things that I don't even consider. Mm. And, you know, like somebody comes to me and they're presenting, let's say if they're at school, a student presents the fact that they're nervous or they're worried about performing. I just don't even think about that. That's always been the case. I mean, I've been nervous, but there are certain things that I definitely just don't even pay them attention. So, like, how do you handle that pressure? What is it, just that you're just worried about it?
I think it is second nature for me now, but when I actually think about what I do, I'm pretty much an open book. Like, if I'm nervous or worried or something's going on, I can tell the people closest to me. And I went to boarding school, so I would call my mum every night. So I don't know if it's come from that, where you're on the phone with your mum, so you have to talk. Whereas, like, if she was just there, I might just be like, yeah, training was good, and, like, shut off the conversation. Yeah. So I don't know if that's got something to do with it. But, yeah, just talking things through is definitely a way that I've been able to cope with things. And I just remembered the World Championships in 2019 was the qualifications for the Olympics, and I just put so much pressure on myself. This is kind of going away from diet, but just in terms of handling pressure. And then Elliot came out to Germany the night before the competition, and he just said, how are you feeling? And I bottled it all up inside of me, because training was going well. There was no reason for me to be so nervous or put that much pressure on myself. But I just had, because obviously this was my dream to qualify the next day in the competition. And when he asked me, I just burst into tears and just was like, I'm so nervous. And but then actually speaking it out, that definitely helped. So just,
that's one of the ways,
yeah, being able to know talking it out helps.
I was just going to say, I'd also say with you, Danusia, that you're, I think probably because your esteem is so good, is so well, that you're very good at not giving up any ground on a matter that might cause a negative influence on your performance, not just in gymnastics but in general. So, for example, if I was to speak to Danusia in a tone that she's not appreciating, why are you talking to me like that? or it might be a case that other people that have some control over environment might do something, and you're very good at questioning it right away. I don't think that's right.
But
why
goes
did you
back
do
to
that?
The point I made. You've got to, you know, it's healthy to say to someone, "This is, well, hang on, what's going on here?" It's important to do that.
Yeah.
It's really interesting, and you're really lucky that you have that. But do you guys? Because I really struggle with telling other people that I'm not necessarily close with, that actually, you know, your comment about my weight or your comment about how I'm handling things has such a negative effect, and I something I really struggle with in saying to them. If I could say it as Madam Mumu, I can't say it as Chris.
I'm learning from Danusia. Right. So that's the one I've definitely learned to be more assertive, and also through you've already said this, Chris, that through therapy you realized that your emotional self had actually quite a logical intent. And I think that a lot of people, including myself, have habitually thought that if I'm feeling something, that's just like an angry child in my head that I can kind of just pass to one side. There's no logic there. But if you listen to it and you question it, you realise there's logic there. So if I feel that someone's spoken to me and it's riled me up to a level where I'm not consciously aware of, but I know it's affected me, then I think that, especially with, you know, good old traditional manners, you should be able to express yourself. So I don't quite like how you just spoke to me back then. I'm not too sure why, but is there any reason why you're speaking to me in that way? I think that's quite admirable, right?
When you present that to somebody, sometimes you might get somebody who's horrified that's the impression they might have put across to you. I mean, obviously, like Chris has said, you know, I've had people say, oh, look at that fat guy over there and stuff like that, and that impacted me for years. And my friends will, you know, attest to the fact that previously I used to get really, really super cross and super angry, but never with the person that had said it. You know, I'd be riled up and I'd be across, but that person had gone, you know, and I'm not a violent person at all, but I'd be like shaking, like how dare somebody talk to me like that? It's just, I wouldn't do that to somebody else.
I have this weird thing that I do where I have almost like an argument of what I should have said.
Or you say, you do the argument afterwards.
And you think of
an amazing comeback.
And it's a great way of being like, do you know what, you moron? This is, you know, I had
you
an
can,
incident
you can
last
be
not
fresh
last,
with it. Say what you want to say.
Last night that was I just don't get where it comes from. I won't mention the person, but I was just like, what does my weight have to do with you? And obviously, it's caused a bit of an argument this morning. And it's fine, but it's like, I should have said something. Mm. You know, this is the point of therapy, is to say to people, that's a trigger for me. Don't say that. Yeah. You know, don't talk about my body when I haven't brought it up. And and then you have this argument with this person in the mirror, and then you get caught doing it. And it's really embarrassing. But it's a great way of kind of, you know,
getting it out.
Mm. You actually have to, the way to stop it is by talking to that person.
I mean, the first time I did that, I did actually challenge somebody on what they'd said to me. And again, I won't name names, but I'd walked into this room and this person had just said, oh, you're looking like you've put on a load of weight. And I'd just walked into the room. Yeah. Like, it wasn't even a hello. It was no greeting at all. And it really took me by surprise. And I sort of went off into a different part of, there was an office off the, you know, and I went and worked there. And I sat in there sort of trying to work, and I just couldn't focus on what I was doing because that bothered me so much. And I think had it been maybe a passing comment where that person had left, it might have been different. But it was a real moment where I just stood up and said, no, hang on, this person's all right. I've got a relationship in a professional sense, so I should be able to turn around and say, hang on. And I actually stepped up and I went and said, look, I just want to say I don't appreciate how you spoke to me there. Whether you meant to offend me or not, it has. And actually, I'm trying to do something about it. Mm. So I appreciate your concern to an element there, but what I don't appreciate is the way you've said it. So, yeah. You know, listen, support me 100%. I would love that, but just think about it. I often think it's people's blindness to what that, not putting myself into a minority category, but he is completely cool with his weight. He's completely happy with it all. And so therefore to him, it's an ordinary comment to make. You know, he doesn't understand that perhaps prior to that, the weeks leading up to that point, I've had a really tough time, but I've done really well, you know. And actually, at that point, I was just on the cusp of starting my boxing with you and starting to do stuff with Elliot for the first time and really sort of getting on that ride. And it could have, and in the past, a comment like that would have made me go, well, what's the point? Yeah. You know, let's go and get a Big Mac, you know, or whatever other Macs are available. But, you know, I would have...
Small Macs.
Pointless, though. But you know, it would have completely just shattered everything I'd worked towards at that point. So that was one of the big reasons why.
One helpful quote that I came across the other day is from a psychologist, Nathaniel Brandon, and he's written a book called The Six Pillars of Self-Esteem. And he says you always have to remember that assertiveness is not a gift; it's something that has to be practiced. Mm. And if you do not practice being assertive, you will not be an assertive person.
Oh, don't
get me
wrong. I was shitting myself, 100%. Like walking out of that room to go and not challenge, but to go and say something. I was like, oh, I don't know how this is going to go. They might be really cross with me because I've said that. But I thought, you know what? So what? They've made me feel cross. So you know, at the very least, I'll feel better, and I might have just shared some of the, you know, frustration and that feeling that I'm feeling with the person that, you know, generated it for me. But
one of my coaches at university, she always said you can say anything you want as long as you say it with respect. Yeah. So had he come to you and said, look, I'm a bit concerned, and said it in a nice, genuine way,
absolutely,
then obviously you wouldn't have taken it in the way you did. And yeah, that's something that I tend to live by, as Elliot knows.
For example, my mother-in-law, she's not my mother-in-law, we're not married, but she has this fixation on my weight. And it's I have this app called Freeletics. I don't know if you guys ever heard it, but it's like 121 pounds, or I think it was on a deal, but basically it's home workouts. I'm a bit nervous about going to the gym at the moment, so it's all about home workouts. With it comes this like diet plan that is really amazing, because you click on what recipes you want, it adds it to a shopping list, and it means that I go into the shop, that's what I buy, and that's it. And I just, like, sometimes she will be like, why have you spent money on that? And I'm like, what's it got to do with you?
It's none of your business.
None of your business. And then it will be a comment of, how's the weight going? Again, none of your business. And it's, people just are not mindful of, actually, you might be saying that from an element of concern, but it's actually coming across as you're an absolute.
Be careful. Be careful, Chris.
And it's really frustrating that people can't kind of come at it with a really positive angle, like, you know, well, you're looking really good. Like, have you been working out?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I have. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Done.
It's education, isn't it? I think. Yeah. Because, like, as you say, people might come at it thinking, oh, I'm saying it from my heart. It's a concern of mine that I'm saying, oh, how's your weight loss going? But really, they need to know that it's not a subject that should necessarily be spoken about unless the person that you're speaking about brings it up themselves. Mm. I had a really, really weird a relationship with my weight for years back before, just before I met my wife. My granddad passed away and I developed OCD, which I still have now, which is a bugger to deal with. But instead of, like we were talking about, how some people's coping mechanisms are to eat, my coping mechanism became not to eat. And I lost so much weight. And I know it's very strange. This is a podcast, no one can see what I look like. But to see me now, you'd never think that back in 2012, 2013, you could see my collarbones, you could see my ribs through my T-shirt. Because I was only eating like 300 to 400 calories a day. And people used to say, once again, kind of off the back of what you say, where people say, how's the weight loss going? People would say, oh, Charlie, you look really good.
Mm.
Because before I was quite, I've always been a heavy set man, really. Oh, Charlie, you look really good. Your weight loss, it looks brilliant. And I'm like,
And they're really celebrating the difficulties that you're having.
Yeah, don't say that because I haven't eaten anything today, and you're going to make me twitch, and I'm going to have to go and wash
it's
my
almost
hands.
Like you've been rewarded. Yeah. And then you think, I've done good, so I'm going to continue.
Exactly.
So, how did you come out of that?
Well, I started to find. So, it was twofold. The food thing was one, I lost my appetite completely and didn't want to eat. And two, I was. One of my main OCD issues is food in general. I'm scared about how things are prepared. I'm scared about whether something has been contaminated somehow, whether it's old food or if someone hasn't washed their hands properly or the plate or the cutlery that I'm using hasn't been cleaned properly. Gradually things get better, usually things get better with time to some extent. I started getting over the death of my granddad, which was the main trigger, I think. And I started being able to eat more foods. I'm still there's foods that I can't touch. I've become a vegetarian now since the beginning of 2020. I became a vegetarian anyway. But meat products were my main thing. Poultry, which obviously is not a good thing not to eat when you are a meat eater because it's lean protein. Mm. So instead, I would be more okay with red meats like steak or mince or burgers, which are full of fat. And so my weight then, as I found the food that I was comfortable with, red meats, starchy things, pizza, which I absolutely adore, my weight went up. And at first I was like, oh, I'm getting better. I feel like I look a normal size again. You can't see my ribs. My legs look better. And I was like, I'm doing something good. But then it went the other way because I was like, I'm doing something good, so I must keep on doing it. And I just went up. I'm currently at the heaviest I've ever been. I believe I haven't stepped on scales in over a year because I'm too scared to. But yeah, I just before me and my wife got married, I was like, right, I've got to do something. I'll start to lose weight before the wedding. And it worked. But once again, I didn't do it in a healthy way. I just stopped eating certain foods, stopped eating so much. I was having about 800 calories a day, and I would make sure that I did not go over that. And then once the wedding was over, that was it. I can eat again.
Game on.
Yeah. And I've only just got to a place now in my life, probably due to lockdown and spending a lot of time sitting around, because obviously some of us might have done this, but we all were like, yeah, I'm gonna be a lot more healthy. I'm gonna go out for a walk every day. I'm gonna go for a cycle or something like this. And 2 or 3 days, and that was done. I didn't do it anymore. I sat on the sofa watching Spider-Man cartoons. and yeah, I've only just started to look in the mirror and go, I'm not upset, which I think is good.
Yeah,
I'm not looking at myself going, oh, you ugly mess. I'm looking at myself going, okay, there's obviously an issue. I need to do something about it.
It's work in progress, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And I haven't started yet. I haven't started doing something about it. But I know that the intent is there, which I think is probably a good starting point. Elliot, would you agree? You're probably the man to speak to about this.
100%. And I think that one dangerous thing that a lot of people do fall into the trap of is asking or placing sole focus on an outcome that they have secondary control over or not instant control over. So as soon as you're looking at weight, you're not actually in control of your weight. Your weight comes from secondary control to your behavior. So it becomes quite a difficulty for people when they try to weigh themselves every day or every other day, and the outcome of that weight is so emotionally loaded that they can ricochet either way.
Yeah.
So if the weight goes down, then they could carry on doing things which might be quite harmful, which is not eating at all.
Yeah.
And if the weight goes up or it doesn't go down too much, then they could ricochet back into that bad behavior, right? Which was leading to that in the first place. Which is why I think, and this is something that we advise all our clients, is to focus on the behavior as much as possible. And asking questions about the behavior can provide much more fruitful, interesting conversation. So for example, if your mother-in-law didn't ask, how's the weight going? She might say something like, oh, I saw that you cooked something the other day. How did you make that? That looks quite healthy. Or it might be, oh, what kind of exercise are you doing? Because I'm kind of trying to get fit as well.
Mm.
Focusing on the behavior that you can actually control can produce far more stable stable effects. But in terms of the intent has to be there without a doubt, but I think the intent should be placed on the behavior rather than the outcome.
Yeah, 100%. And I've had a real argument with my scales over the last few weeks because my
they're not going to argue back, so it's good. It's
well,
good
they argue. Do you they put the wrong number on there basically. So that's the argument I'm having. I had a real argument with my scales in the sense of that I stepped on it. I'd had a poor choice of eating week, let's say, and had been quite frivolous and enjoyed many, many sandwiches from shops and extras. And I thought, well, to preemptively make myself feel okay about the fact that there's going to be a gain, I'll step on the scales the night before I normally do. Stepped on, loss. Oh, no, sorry, maintain. Happy with that. Okay, cool. All right. So in the morning, I'll be all right. Bed, slept, weighed, same clothes, same place, £5 on. And so I know this is a conversation that I've had with Elliot so many times. I've complained to Elliot, oh, the bloody scales. Blah, blah, blah. And he's always turned around and said exactly what he's just said in response to your question. And finally now, however many years we've been working together, an
two,
eternity.
Three,
maybe?
Yeah.
An eternity probably feels like for you. Sorry.
No, it's been fun.
but it's finally, I think I'm finally at a point where I'm starting to accept the fact that it's not that the scales are lying. Is that, like you've just said, you know, your body might be catching up, or it might be slightly ahead of you, or it's not a true reflection of where you are. And so now I'm way more focused on my clothes and how they fit, the fact and images. I actually looked at a photo that you took and we put in that app that we use, Elliot. I looked at that in comparison to a photo of me now, and the difference is unbelievable. And again, maybe because I didn't really want to look at myself, I've never done that before. That was the first time I've done that since you took that photo. Like, they've just been there, you know, in the app, not making... And that's the purpose of it, isn't it? So you can track it. So
exactly
to visually
right.
see the difference, hearing from people, wow, you're looking different, that's amazing. But it's frustrating. It's very expensive with clothes, though, at the moment. You know, these jeans are like 3 weeks old and they're too big and they look like clown trousers at the top and... You know, I may look silly. I probably don't, but...
Get yourself a pair of dungarees.
Dungarees, mate, yes.
doesn't matter how big or small
pocket.
You are.
Yep. You could put your iPad in there and anything.
Oh, I like that.
Chuck the shoulders on, they fit anyone.
They do.
Nice.
I might have to, yeah, dungaree it up.
Yes.
Can you go dungaree shopping with me when we're out of tier three?
I'll take you, man, I'll take you.
So, yeah, I think now I'm far more accepting of, not entirely convinced. Still, I know that there's a little voice at the back of my head that will go, that weight's gone up. That means you've put weight on. You failed. That will still happen, but I hope that the voice is louder saying, yeah, but your jeans are way too big for you, and you know, you look like you're wearing clown trousers, son, so, you know, crack on. But it's just such a mental argument in your head, isn't there? Constant argument.
It's, I mean, half the time when, you know, we're out there and we're thinking, oh my God, that's what people are thinking, they're actually not.
They're worried about their own insecurities.
Yeah, and it's really kind of frustrating to... And it's not a sense of, oh my God, people must be thinking what I'm doing. I'm not thinking like that. I'm just comments make me think, what are you seeing that I can't see? Because when I'm naked in the shower and I'm looking in the mirror, I'm like, I can see some improvement.
Mm.
You know, I look down and I can see my toes. And, you know, when I go for a run, I'm improving my times. But that comment just makes you go, oh, hold up, what is it that you're seeing? And it's kind of, it's frustrating. And then that makes you think, oh, what's what are point? Other people thinking? Yeah. And yeah,
and you do start to question whether there's any point in doing anything with it at all. That's how certainly I did. I don't so much anymore.
2020.
It's strange, isn't it? Because I can't remember what it was I was watching or listening to. I hope to God it wasn't this podcast.
Well, I hope to God it was.
Maybe it was. I mean, don't know. But I might be re-quoting something that someone said. I just didn't want to say it.
And let's pretend that I know. I'll tell you if it was a quote.
Okay,
because
cool.
I can remember everything.
Someone was saying about how we're all the centre of our own universe.
Yeah, that was definitely on here.
Was it on here?
I have no idea. I think it was. I do think it was.
The centre of our own universe, and when we go out into the streets or wherever we go, to our place of work or to the shops, we all think that people are looking at us.
Yeah, I think that was Toby that said that.
Maybe, yeah. We all think someone's looking at us and they're judging us, they're thinking about, oh, look, that person's fat or that person's ugly or this and the other. And the fact of the matter is, no one's looking at you because you're insignificant in the world. I mean, that sounds a horrible way of putting it.
Well, but them you are, aren't
yeah, they? Yeah. No one's even noticed that you're walking down the street. So you need to kind of not put that much weight on your shoulders about that. Mm. Like, people aren't looking at you. People aren't judging you. People aren't thinking that fat, ugly mess. You know, if anything, they might look at you and go, oh, that's a nice top that person's wearing. I'm gonna go and find that online. Or,
yeah.
Or that person is wearing
where
this makeup.
Where did you get those dungarees from?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Boohoo men.
Is there such a place?
Boohoo men.
Is it?
Of course there is.
Yeah.
Product placement.
And I tell
well
you
done.
What, they're plus size, they're big and large boy clothes, spot on.
Oh, well.
This, perfect.
It's really interesting you say about like what other people, you know, people aren't. I was tagged in an Instagram post, got back from lockdown 1.0, had made this new dress, which was a baby doll silhouette. So a baby doll silhouette is kind of, it sits right under your armpits and it just bellows out. Yes, okay, I'm a, you know, 6 foot four man in heels. Obviously, I'm going to look a lot larger. But this woman tagged me in a post and there I was singing and one of her guests from her party went, looks like someone's put a lot of weight on during lockdown 1.0. And I was like, why have you tagged me in this post? Because, you know, are you really not that aware?
That's not a nice thing to hear.
Yeah, and it
that's
kind
disgusting.
Of...
disgusting.
Yeah, it does make you... And then luckily she went, I don't think it's the weight, I think it's the dress.
Yeah.
And it was just like...
Doesn't matter. Really.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And then it feeds into that when you go in somewhere, you're like, people must be, because if that's what they
but
say...
But that's where you are... As a performer, you are putting yourself on a stage.
Big time.
You know, and they are going to comment on you, and they are looking at us on stage, and they are looking at what we're doing and how we look and how we sound. So that's where that fragility may come from, is, you know, you are exposing yourself to people. Well, not you know what I mean, like you're exposing... Yeah. Maybe
sometimes.
You do. I don't, but not anymore. But you are, you know, you're leaving yourself open to that sort of criticism or those sorts of comments, and, you know... That lady might have said that, and she might have said that as a joke to her friend, you know. Mm. And but to her, that's funny. But to you and to anybody else that might hear that, that's not on. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really not on.
One thing that kind of struck me when you said that, or one question that struck me when you said that, and it's similar to what I've known you to experience as well. Is that, do you think that people are for some reason more overtly offensive or controversial towards your alter ego? I.e. towards Madam, is it Madam Moomoo, than they are to Chris?
I think, like, I'm sure you're the same, and you would be the same, and everyone would be the same. You just feel like people are always saying things to, I see it from both angles. Like, it's, and I know it's my issue. I know it's me going, hold up, maybe I'm misunderstanding, hence why I'm going to therapy. Maybe I'm misunderstanding the world.
There may be an element of misunderstanding, but I do think it goes back to what Charlie said about the educational aspect of it as well.
Yeah.
And actually,
yeah.
There isn't... One
am
of
I
the
just hanging out with uneducated people?
We're all hanging out with uneducated people. We're all uneducated ourselves.
One of the things I try and teach my students, in addition to the music stuff I'm trying to teach them, is that you've got to... That whole idea, your university teacher said, say whatever you want, but say it with respect. You know, think about the words that are coming out of your mouth, you know, before, and think about the impact of what your words will have on that person. Mm. And that's a society thing. I really feel strongly about that. It's a society thing. Some families, they say whatever they want to each other, and in part, maybe that's healthy. Some families, they won't talk to each other about the tough stuff, and maybe that's healthy for them. But actually, there needs to be some real middle ground, doesn't there? It really does.
And you'll know, working with kids, kids can be really nasty sometimes. But they don't even mean it either.
Exactly. And that's just down to the fact that they haven't learnt yet the social cues or the etiquette that may be required in that environment. And I think it's really important that we teach our young people to do that properly. You know, I think young people get a really bad rep. And often when I say I'm a teacher, they go, oh, it must be so tough. Kids are awful. Well, some kids are, of course. But the majority, I would say a huge majority of the students I teach are amazing. And they all have personal lives. They all have things going on in their lives that we often forget as adults because we're so wrapped up in our own. And actually what we should be doing, in addition to teaching them our subjects, is helping them to develop the skills through the lives that they're leading right there and then. You know, I don't know the ins and outs of every one of my students. So I always try and approach you with what's going on at home, what might be happening for them right now.
Because you're battling whatever they're learning at home as well.
Well,
you know.
but not only from their personality and their behaviour, but there could be loads of things happening. Yeah. So that's that's often forgotten. I'm so appreciative of the fact that in my school that's not the case, but in a great deal of educational settings it is, because it's, well, sit down, here's your book, learn this, do exam, pass, grades, done, go live your life. Well, it's not that, is it, really?
Because you haven't taught me how to live my life. Just taught me how to do maths.
Pass the test. Yeah. with maths in mind, and we're going to have a piece of music. And music do link very nicely.
Music is math in a strange way.
In a strange sort of way. Music-related maths jokes, please send in on our social media. We'll listen to them. Yeah. Charlie. You're going to do a piece of music for us. What are you going to perform for us?
I think I'm going to do a Follow Hawk song.
Yep.
I'm going to do one of the songs that's on the new EP.
Yeah. What's the new EP called?
I think it's called Take Two.
Take Two.
I think. Maybe. I might be
wrong.
You're
looking at me as if I know. I haven't got a clue.
I really don't know myself. And we've actually decided not to name these songs because they were our first songs that we ever wrote.
Okay.
That kind of fell to the wayside. We went on and wrote more songs and recorded them. And then we came back to these ones and thought, actually, these are really good songs. Let's record them. And we decided we're not going to give them names. We're just going to call them 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
Because there's 3 tracks. And this is going to be song 2, not to be confused with
the Blur song 2.
No
wahooing.
No wahooing. Unless you request really nicely. No wahooing.
All right. So you're going to perform. It's a Follow the Hawk song.
Yes.
Two.
I'm
just going to call it two.
Track two, whatever you
Follow mean. The Hawk 2.
Thank you. It started this, well, the answer's me. Satisfied with the remaining 3. Now and again I start to think, what is the point of searching for the missing link? Set our sail, that's when we start to sink. The starting line where I began to crack, see exactly where the morals lack. And those days are where you turn to drink, because it clouds your mind, you find it hard to think. Set our sail, that's when we start to sink. Still fit, happy to got a secret. It's kept behind doors. I think I found it. And then it all disappears.
Follow the Hawk 2, that's called 2, just to be clear. Very, very good. And when can we expect that EP to be out? Come on.
Now you're asking hard questions. it's sometime before the mid-2021, we should hope. It was planned for January time,
yeah,
but we've had a few hiccups recording-wise or production-wise. So hopefully mid-2021.
Okay, great. All right, well, it sounds great. And you're okay to do another track for us a little bit later as well?
Yeah, sure.
We'll finish off with your track at the end, if that's all right, mate. Cool, it'll be wonderful. Okay, so Chris, I just want to come to you with regards to your milliner.
Yeah.
So you are the creator of hats.
Correct.
Quick question. Am I a hat? Do I have a hat face? Because I've often been told I look like a twerp in a hat.
Everyone has a hat face.
Do they?
Yeah, it comes from, again, it's, you know, you've just got to find the right hat, and then once you've found that right hat, you've just got to wear it with confidence.
I think in the first email I sent to you rather tentatively, I think at the end I said, and hopefully when we meet you can finally answer the question of what hat should I be wearing.
That, you know, there's some people that have a face shape, usually if it's like a, you know, if they've got very angular features or a sweetheart kind of face shape, they can...
Please tell me I have a sweetheart face.
You've got a very square jaw, which is an angular feature. So you, they can kind of wear absolutely any hat they want to.
All right.
But then if you get people who, you know, have a bit more of a round face or, you know, a different shape face, they've got to, you know, their choices aren't as varied.
They're limited.
I've definitely got a square head.
I think you and I,
definitely.
So are we are the same, aren't we?
We are the same.
But that's not a bad thing, because there are hats out there that
means we've got
you.
Hat versatility.
Which hats?
So, for example, like...
I mean, Elliot's getting married soon. Do you need a hat for your marriage?
I'm imagining it now. Yeah. Like, it's filling that space on my head.
It's whether Danusia's going to allow it. I think I just saw a look of, yeah.
So, it doesn't just come down to your face shape. It also comes down to your height. So if you are a really tall person, don't wear... tall hats, because you'll forever be walking into doorways, low light fittings. And what it also does is generally tall people have long features, so it also like will extend your face, making it look longer. So if you're a short person, avoid wide brims. So you don't want to go around looking like a mushroom. And also you'll spend the rest of your day with your head tilted backwards trying to look at people through your brim.
Can I call you every time I think about buying a hat in
a shop? Absolutely.
Just be like, Chris, is this the one for me?
Well, yeah. I think it's a good thing to go to any hat shop and try on as many hats as you can. Is you do the same with clothes, and you do the same with sunglasses or, you know, particular brands of underwear, for example, until you find the right fit that's really comfortable. Mm. So do the same with a hat. And, you know, don't let the hat wear you, wear the hat.
Do you reckon I'm a bowler man? I reckon I could rock a bowler hat.
But a bowler hat would look good.
Yeah.
A bowler hat would look good.
With an umbrella.
A trilby or fedora would also look really nice.
Fedora, you'd
fedora?
Look good with a fedora.
What's that?
Fedora. That's the old Frank Sinatra used to wear.
Yeah.
Fedora. Think mafia. Sort of, yeah.
They've kind Wicked of got a dimple in the middle with
yeah,
two
yeah.
dimples.
I'm on that,
100%.
Like a noir detective.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, I like that.
Elliot Reid.
Fedora.
Detective.
That's my dad. DC Reed,
yeah.
Didn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, done. We'll get you a fedora for your wedding gift.
There's loads of hats out there. You've just got to, you know, put it on. And it's interesting when you go to like events like Royal Ascot, and you can see people who have come for the first time, and they kind of walk around a bit subconscious, and they're constantly touching their hat. And that's just a sign of, one, it's either not comfortable, two, it's the first time you've worn a hat. You know, put it on your head. Don't touch it and own it.
You've done some, from what I understand anyway, you've done some pretty cool, well, you've made some hats for some pretty cool people. Is there anything you can tell us about any of that, or is it all hush, hush, secret?
I've been very I suppose, honoured to make a hat for Princess Beatrice and also Autumn Phillips. And yeah, I mean, I've my label's small, but I've done some nice things with it. I got my first cover a couple of weeks ago for India Cosmopolitan.
That's great.
Well, my hat was on the cover on an amazing actress who I never knew existed until then, called Sanam Kapoor, and she is huge in the Bollywood scene. She's got like 30.4 million followers on Instagram. She's absolutely massive. And but then they credited the wrong designer, which was a bit of a kick in the teeth. But you know, it's fine. It's fine.
Still, that must make you feel incredibly proud. And yeah, proud, obviously. And I hope you feel proud about that, because that sounds incredible.
Yeah,
an amazing achievement as well.
It's kind of like your first hit, and then you want the next hit, and can be dangerous.
But no, something that will keep you aspiring towards it, though. And I think especially when you're, it sounds like in your context, you're working a job in order to support that.
Yes,
fundamentally. And so that, you know, to have those moments of success really, you know, it justifies the blood, sweat and tears that you have going through everything else just to make that work.
Well, it's like an Olympian. I mean, you know, I didn't realize that Olympians, they obviously get sponsorship, but a lot of it comes from you actually funding it. And I think that's, you know, it's incredible to do that for your craft. I think it's dedication. So well done.
Thank you.
I'm feeling a lot of love in the room.
The other thing that stood out when you were introducing yourself that I felt like I could relate to was how you had this dream from, was it 11 years old? And you had the label name and everything. It's like you manifested it from such a young age.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah.
You've got to think it to achieve it, is that what you're saying?
Were you six? You were six or seven when you first saw the Olympics?
Yeah, I was six. So
was
I was kind
of
like...
That was a case of you saw that and like, that's me. That's what I want.
Literally, there was a gymnast, a Russian gymnast, and it was her, that particular performance. She was just so charismatic and confident in how she finished her floor routine. She had like a gunshot and then she like blew it, and I was just like, yes, I need to be like that
so
at
good.
The Olympics.
Have you met her, or have you?
I actually haven't met her specifically, but I've met a lot of my idols along the way.
Good.
And then Usain Bolt is obviously everyone's a fan of him. I've been a massive fan of him, and then joining his team with joining Jamaica was just amazing. And then finally, like, meeting him. He's incredible, and just his charisma and everything.
I'm astounded that that's
so
a true
jealous.
Story.
No, it is a true
story. No, I don't disbelieve it. What I'm saying is, I can't believe that Usain Bolt's name is being used by someone who's met the guy.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Is he cool? He seems super cool.
Literally
doesn't he?
The coolest person ever. Because you know they say don't meet your idols because they disappoint you, but he didn't.
Nice.
He's amazing.
Does he? So will he be going to Tokyo? I don't quite know. Is he retired? Is he can? He's going to go to Tokyo.
He is retired, but I would assume he might be there in some capacity.
Okay, but he's not running. He's not.
He's
performing.
Not
like an ambassador.
Nice.
Yeah, you'd hope.
Well, I mean, feel
well,
free.
Who knows if COVID,
feel
though.
Free to share. You know, the wedding thinners with Usain. See, you know, he might want to get involved. You know,
have him on the podcast.
Could you imagine?
I can, and I'm manifesting it in my mind right now. We, Rich, Adam, and I, when we sat back a few months, about a couple of months ago, we were like, so who's our ultimate goal? Who do we want on? Who would be like, you're all wonderful to be here, by the way.
Thanks.
I don't mean that, you know, you're all second rate. But we were like, well, we will want Dave Grohl. So
if you are putting me on that podcast, if you have Dave Grohl on this
I don't
podcast.
Think for a moment just yet we're going to get him. We're not quite there, but you never know. Never know. I'm gonna start with Tom Watson first. I keep saying his name.
I met Dave Grohl once. I have a really good story, actually, if I'm allowed to tell it.
Yep.
So I was working at...
Do you still have his mobile number?
I don't. No. I wish. I never got it. I was working at Download Festival 1 year, and they, in the catering tent, really weird place to put it, they had a tattoo parlour, so you could get your lunch and have a tattoo right next to it.
Of course.
Perfect for hygiene.
Or maybe you had to tattoo the menu, what you wanted, and just show them.
Exactly. And I went in and I got booked in. I was going to go and sit down and have this tattoo, and he'd drawn it on my back. I said, I'm just going to nip to the loo. So I ran to the toilet, and as I was coming back, I heard... Now, I'm a massive Foo Fighters fan, and I heard him laugh, and I was like, I know that laugh. I turned around, and it was Dave Grohl and Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age, because them Crooked Vultures were playing there. And I thought, I can't even go up to him. That's ridiculous. And then I thought to myself, when am I ever going to get this opportunity again? So I just walked up to him and said, oh, Mr. Grohl, like my bottom lip going like this. So would I be able to have a picture, please? He said, yeah, sure. And he threw his bag down and put his arm around me. And it's really weird when you look at the photograph. It looks like he's trying to have a picture taken with me. It's really strange. But I walked back, like, legs like jelly, sat down to get this tattoo. I was like, I can't believe it. I just met Dave Grohl. And then he walks into the catering tent with Taylor Hawkins, the drummer from Foo Fighters, because he was playing there with his other band. They sit down and have their lunch. And they get up and they come over and they stand and watch me get my tattoo done. And I was just sat there like, don't cry. Don't look like a wuss. And that's my Dave Grohl story.
Wow.
That's great. I have nothing interesting like that. Adam, do you have any stories? No, nothing? Wow, that's I would love to meet him. Stevie Wonder would like to meet as well.
Oh wow.
Yeah, good old Stevie.
I love Stevie.
That'd be one, wouldn't it? One day.
I once really insulted Morrissey.
Good.
I didn't know who he was. And it was, I was working in, when I started at Harrods, I was working as a Dolce & Gabbana brand specialist. And I came back from my break and I walked in and immediately I saw this customer stood by the till with no one there. And I was like, oh, you know, do you need any help? As I'm putting my bag away in my drawer. And he kind of says, oh, no, don't worry, I've been seen to. And does this hand motion. And I was like, you need to simmer down, like, yeah, you know, a bit rude. But I noticed this ring on his finger and I was like, wow, that ring's cool. So I went to the till to log on and do what I needed to do. So I thought, I'm not just going to have this customer stand here and, you know, not talk to them. So I was like, you know, where did you get your ring from? It's really nice. And I was like, oh, this old thing, it's a tiger's eye. And I was like, oh, it's amazing. So what do you do? And I was like, I'm an artist. So I was like, so like, do you finger paint or like, what do you do? And he went, tell you what. And he pulled up this Harrods bag. And inside, we used to have HMV at Harrods and had all these CDs. And on the front of the CD was his face. Oh. And he was like, here's my music, listen to it. You'll never go back and you'll never go forward. And I was like, wow, you are so arrogant.
I can't believe obviously he had his own CD in a bag.
I didn't say that. So obviously he gave it to me. And by this time, my colleague who was serving him was back and he was like, oh my God. I was like, why is Tim looking so weird? So I said to him, I'm really sorry. I can't accept this because obviously of security questions. But I do have a question for you. Do you buy your own music to like up your record sales?
So good.
So by this time, Tim was like jaw down to the ground. Yeah. And I gave him back a CD and then I was like, listen, it's really lovely to meet you, but good luck in your career. And I trotted off and then I came back and I went, I'm so sorry, I've forgotten your name. I need to look you up on iTunes. Can you spell it out for me? And got him to spell out his whole name. Yeah, it was
hilarious.
It was really bad. And then everyone was like, I can't believe you've done that.
Sounds like the medicine he needed, though. That's yeah, just what he needed.
I don't think that's not the first story I've heard of him being a little bit arrogant and arsey.
Do you think he buys his own CDs to give them to people?
Maybe.
The bag was filled.
He must have those CDs.
What, of his own CDs?
Of his own CDs.
No.
Yeah, seriously.
Why would you do that?
And I was like, and there was this one designer called Neil Barrett, and he used a picture of Morrissey on the front of his T-shirt for one of his collections. And I noticed one day he was in to look at said T-shirt. And I walked past him and we kind of clocked eyes and he was like, you now know who I am. And I was like, I'm the person that once asked you if you buy your CDs. And it was this moment of a kind of like feeling a bit cheeky. But yeah, it was funny.
Well, he's human at the end of the day, isn't he? So, yeah.
Is he?
Well,
not sure.
He doesn't act it sometimes, perhaps, but that's fascinating. I still don't have anything interesting to say about any stories that I can recall, but I like the fact you served him a little bit there. Yeah. Good.
Such a good story.
Yeah, good. So we've had Usain Bolt, Dave Grohl, Morrissey.
Well, I've got a few reality TV stars that come into the clinic. They've been a mixed bunch, for sure. You actually want to go a bit deeper than that.
I mean, if you want to leave it there, you can leave it there. That's fine. It wasn't intending to be a podcast on Who Have You Met? That's a whole new podcast.
Name Drop
it?
FM.
Yeah.
There's this one reality TV star who was trying to become quite popular on TV. And she had this MTV film set come in and record an edition. And it was just bad. Like, it was real bad. I didn't like her at all. She said to me, I think this was at the end of recording, she went, and I'm sorry, Nuj, but she said, you really want me, don't you? I said, what? She said, you find me really attractive. I said, nah, I don't. She said, you do. I said, I can tell. I said, I'm being serious. You're fully not my type at all. And she was so insistent, and she actually like texted me a few times after that. I was like, sorry, I'm not interested. And actually, when it aired, I think we'd been together for like what, 2-3 months, I think.
Yeah.
About that. Yeah. I found, to be fair, when she came to the clinic, the way that the producers treated her, I could see how they could manifest that type of personality, because it's really quite.
It's just not real, is it?
I don't
despite
like
it being
dude.
Called
like,
reality TV.
Yeah, and I know that Noosh knows that I just hate that whole reality TV. So I look, obviously, you dabble in it, you like watching it. I hate it so much. I think it's such a just a narcissistic.
Well, my wife has got me. Well, I'm not hooked anymore. I'm off of it. But the I think it's called the Billy Fares Mummy Diaries.
Yeah,
you watch that?
I don't watch it, but I've watched it.
Yeah.
What's that about?
Well,
Billy
Fares. Sam, is it Sam and Billy
Fares?
Yeah,
Billy.
Sam.
I don't know.
Well, if you don't know it, mate, you're just not in my league.
I just don't know. I think for me to summarise my opinion, I don't understand how people can be famous or valued just for their personalities. I don't get it.
Head in the clouds.
Like, at least like produce something that's like entertaining.
Well, in fairness to those two, like they, I get them confused. Is Sam the? Oh, I don't know. Anyway, one of them has a clothing line now, and you know that's interesting seeing that side of it. And actually, I think them doing this is probably. Made them a bit more personable and a bit more normal, but I do sit like you, Charlie. I'm like, well, that's not real. You know, those children are growing up in that house like this. They're going to be complete arses by the end of it, but they won't be, I'm sure.
We watch a lot.
Shouldn't slate them. I shouldn't at this point. I should say I'm sure they're absolutely lovely.
Hannah watches a lot of YouTube stuff with
the wedding thing is YouTube. You mean?
Yeah, obviously that's the only thing she watches. Yeah. Thanks. And loads of like families and celebrities, air quotation marks. Who are just famous for being famous, so to speak, who might now have clothing lines and this, that, and the other. And some I do find very funny, some I enjoy watching because it's like car crash TV, you can't look away. But some of these people have got this sense of grandiose that just makes absolutely no sense. Where did you get that? What is your purpose?
That really TV star who came in, I started to talk to her, and the producer said, no, don't talk to her.
That's
so we want to keep
disgusting.
It organic. Yeah, so we want to keep it organic for TV. We want it to be real. Yeah, it's mad. After one thing I did come across on YouTube the other day, there was a highlight reel of Gemma Collins. She's so funny.
She is
that killed me. No, you don't find her funny. Where she's saying,
I just find her
go,
really.
She wants
maybe
to come
I shouldn't, because you
she
don't know where this is
going to
go, do you?
See, I think she wants to come out of the jungle. She's like, let me go. She went, I don't need the money. I've got money. I was found her hilarious, man. I'm claustrophobic, Darren.
Yeah.
What was that?
She's having a breakdown.
Like
she's like, I don't want to play anymore. Effing games.
I do respect the fact that she completely says as she feels.
Yeah.
Like, that's pretty cool. And frightening as well.
I think there's a good thing with her. I think there's a difference between there's that she knows that she's a parody of herself.
I wonder if she's in a mode.
Yeah. Big time. Big time.
A lot of stars are. Sorry, we've turned into like a tea jam.
Yeah, well, anyway, the Wedding Thinners podcast is still available. Tune in.
I was just going to say, when I met, whilst I worked at the theatre, which is actually, I saw you there last, Tom, because you came and brought your students in. I wasn't sure it was you because I didn't know you were a teacher.
Oh, at the Orchard?
Yes.
At Dartford?
Yes.
What a theatre.
But we had Louis Spence for a pantomime one year. And he's completely different in his own persona. But when he becomes Louis Spence, once again, air quotation marks. He's completely switched off. He's just a normal person. Because, of course, how can you be that manic at all points in your life?
Yeah, and you need to save it as well. Yeah, it's burning out is the key there, isn't it? You need to save it.
Turn it on and turn it off.
Yeah. Yes, it's not an unlimited resource, I don't think. Well, listen, I really appreciate the fact that all of you have come to have a chat with Adam and myself. I know Adam's, he's pushing the buttons, but we really appreciate the fact that you're there as well, Adam. Thank you. And, Chris Garner, thank you very much
thank
for joining
for
us today.
Me.
And please do post anything you're doing, any of your successes, anything like that. Feel free to share it. We'd love to keep in touch.
Thank
and
you.
What would be amazing, I said this in a short break we had, it would be amazing to maybe have you guys back. You know, you can always join us virtually as well at some point down the line. And Charlie, you know, all the best with your EP and your Christmas tune. And
thank you.
An amazing job you're doing, so much for charity. And good on you, mate, because, you know, not enough people do that. So thank you. Elliot, thank you, mate. constantly, like, I don't say thank you enough to you. Thank you very much.
Pleasure, man.
For joining us and for everything else as well. And Danusia is going to the Tokyo Olympics next year. Yay! And say hi to Usain and well done. And thank you all very, very much. We're going to finish up with another performance from Charlie. What are you going to perform for us now?
Do the most depressing song in the world.
Brilliant.
We're going to do Penny Royal Tea by Nirvana.
Wonderful. This is Charlie Barnes with Penny Royal Tea by Nirvana.
I'm on my time with everyone. I have very bad posture. Sit and drink Penny Royal Tea. Distill the life that's inside of me. Sit and drink Penny Royal Tea. I'm a needed royalty. Eternally, I'm so tired I can't sleep. I'm a liar and a thief. Sit and drink Penny Royal Tea. I'm a
lovely Nirvana track. Thank you ever so much. Just wrapping up and finishing up, how can we find out more about you, Chris, and the things you're doing with your Julian Garner? What can people do to find out more?
Julian Garner, at Julian Garner on Instagram, and at Madam Moo Moo Official again on Instagram, or moomooexperience.com.
Amazing. Okay, Charlie, follow the Hawk stuff. Tell me about that. Where can we find more about you, dude?
Yep, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Just look, follow the Hawk. I can't tell you which one's which, but it's either Follow the Hawk Band or Follow the Hawk UK.
Okay, Elliot, your Revitalize Clinic. Anything else that anybody needs to know? Where can they find you?
Yeah, you can find me on Instagram at Elliot John Reid, it's double L double T, and at www.revitalizeclinic.co.uk.
Brilliant. And Danusia, we want to support you for Tokyo, so we want to be cheering from the stands virtually from afar, but how can we do that on your socials?
Thank you so much. Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at Danusia Francis and danusiafrancis.co.uk.
Amazing. Brilliant. Thank you all so much once more. Thank you very much. Thank Episode you. 12. Is it 12, Adam? It's 12. Yeah. Episode 12. Thank you, Adam.
The Wedding Feelers Podcast. Listen to our podcast. The buffet's closed. We're smaller.